My name is Adam Hincks. I'm an assistant professor in the Department of Astronomy here at the University of Toronto, and I also have an appointment at St. Michael's College. The cosmic microwave background, which we abbreviate CMB, is the oldest light in the universe. So essentially, when you're looking at the CMB, you're looking at the universe soon after the Big Bang. All there was a almost perfectly uniform hot gas of hydrogen and helium. And that gas was glowing. Everything that has a temperature glows. And what's incredible is that we can actually see that glow today. It's called the cosmic microwave background. Cosmic because it's cosmic, it comes from everywhere. Microwave because it's not visible light, the kind of light that our eyes are sensitive to, but it's at a longer wavelength, so a wavelength of millimeters and centimeters. So that's why it's called microwave. And background because it's the furthest we can see, so it's like a background to everything else. And you put that together, you get cosmic microwave background, or CMB. Well, you observe the CMB like you observe most other things in astronomy with telescopes. The main difference is that because you're not looking at optical light, the kind of camera you use is different. So you still have a telescope that has a big mirror, but then the technology in the camera is different so that it's sensitive not to, to visible wavelengths of light, but to microwave light. It's actually not that hard to see the microwave background because it's really bright. When you look at the night sky with visible light, most of the sky is dark at night, and then you just get, you know, pinpricks of light where there are stars or galaxies or planets. But it looks very different with microwave light because the whole sky is flooded with microwave light, with this microwave background. So wherever you look, you see this glow of the early universe. And as I said, it's quite bright. So if you're old enough to remember televisions when they had the bunny ears on top, or when you had an antenna on your roof and you switched to where there wasn't a channel and you got the noise on the TV, about 1% of that is actually the cosmic microwave background that your antenna, your television antenna, was picking up. So it's bright enough that you can see it with a fairly, you know, modest telescope or instrument. Well, today you might classify three types of telescopes that we use to look at the CMB. That are distinguished based on where they are. So we have telescopes that are ground-based, typically on high mountains at high altitude, that are specialized for looking at the microwave background. When you looked at them, they would look like ordinary telescopes, except the mirror, you wouldn't be able to see your reflection in them because they're not very good at reflecting visible light. They're designed for reflecting microwave light, but they look like ordinary telescopes, more or less. Then the second type of telescope are balloon telescopes. So this is where you literally take a telescope and you hang it from a giant helium balloon, and it goes up about 50 kilometers to where it's almost in space. And the reason you do that is to get above the atmosphere. With microwave light, the atmosphere is your enemy. The atmosphere emits a lot of microwave light. So if you're at high altitude, you can do a pretty good job, but still the atmosphere is contaminating your signal a little bit. So that's one reason why you would go up in a balloon. And then the third thing you can do that's the most expensive and the most difficult, but in principle the best, is to go into space. So the most recent space telescope for observing the microwave background was the Planck satellite. And the Planck satellite is located in the same neighborhood as the new JWST telescope that everyone's excited about now. The discovery of the CMB was actually quite interesting. In the 40s and 50s, there were some astronomers, some cosmologists, who realized that if the universe began in a Big Bang, you should be able to see the CMB, you should be able to see the glow of the early universe. And so there was a group at Princeton University that was starting to build an instrument to look for this microwave background. Not too far away in New Jersey, there were two other researchers who weren't looking for the CMB, but were commissioning a new telescope. And they had this frustrating problem that wherever they pointed their telescope, they kept seeing this signal that they couldn't explain, and they didn't know where it came from. And they thought it was a problem with the instrument, but they tried everything they could to get rid of it. But at one point, they even thought that it was pigeon droppings. There were all these pigeon droppings in the telescope, and they thought that maybe that was causing the signal. So they cleaned the whole telescope, and it just wouldn't go away. And so they realized that maybe they were actually seeing something that came from outer space. And they called the scientists at Princeton University to see if they knew where the signal might be coming from. And immediately the scientists at Princeton realized that they had found the microwave background that they were planning on looking for. And so the two researchers named Arno Penzias and Wilson, they were awarded the Nobel Prize for their discovery. Even though they weren't looking for it, they had the wherewithal to realize that what they saw was important and to figure out what it was. Well, as I mentioned earlier, the CMB is the very earliest light that we can see in the universe. We're seeing the universe when it was about 400,000 years old, which sounds like a long time, but when you compare that to the total age of the universe, which is about 13 billion years old, it's very, very early on. So just for a sense of scale, if the universe were only 1 year old, that would be like seeing the universe when it was only 15 minutes old. So it's very early on. And so we're really getting a privileged view of what the universe was like early on. A lot of what we can learn from the CMB, we get by connecting what we're seeing in the very early universe to what the universe looks like today. And by comparing kind of the universe today to what it looked like very early on, we can learn a lot of things about the universe as a whole. So one thing you can measure by looking at the CMB is how old the universe is. Some of our most precise measurements of the age of the universe that we know to around a percent precision, we learn from looking at the CMB. It also tells us what the universe is made of. So by looking at the CMB, we've learned that only about 5% of the universe is made up of atoms. That's the stuff that we're made up of. That's the type of matter that we're most familiar with. That's only 5% of the universe. About 25% of the universe is dark matter. We don't really know what dark matter is. We know it's there. We can see its gravitational influence, and it leaves a very distinct impression in the microwave background. And then 70% of the universe is made up of dark energy, this mysterious energy field that's pushing the universe apart and causing it to speed up as it expands. But some of our best measurements of those fractions, you know, 5% from atoms, 25% from dark matter, 70% from dark energy, we get from observations of the microwave background. The one thing that excites a lot of us is that we hope to learn about what happened in the very first instance of the universe, within the first second after the Big Bang. Many cosmologists think that the universe expanded really, really rapidly during that first second. That's called inflation, the period where the universe inflated. If that happened, it would create a very distinctive pattern in the CMB, but a pattern that's extremely faint and that we currently don't have the sensitivity to see. And over the next few years, we hope to get the sensitivity with bigger telescopes and more sensitive measurements to actually detect that pattern. Technically, they're called the B modes. So if we can detect those B modes, that would be really good evidence for inflation. So we'd really be learning incredibly about how the universe was behaving in its very first instance and learning about really fundamental physics.